I should not begin with a question, but anyway, how do you introduce these concepts of emissivity? Meaning, in fact, I don't remember studying irradiation, radiosity, intensity, all these terms. I don't remember them as distinctly as how I remember now, because probably I had not studied it the way it has to be studied. But do you introduce these words, irradiation, radiosity? Anybody who does not introduce these terms to students?
No, but I saw in many of the curriculum,
there are no definitions. It's starting from black body. In many of the curriculum, what I saw in their syllabi, I saw there is no definition of Planck's distribution and all. I mean, directly we are getting into black body. No, I would say half-half.
Probably it is there, it's not put in the syllabus.
No, but Mangesh was, for example, Mangesh's case, he was saying that we assume that everything they know in plus two. But I would suggest that even if they know in plus two, it is a good idea. You see, Professor Arun brought that red light thing. So maybe we might have studied in, what is that, plus two, but it might have not got registered.
Another thing is plus two to third year, 3 years.
Yeah, okay. Maturity levels have gone up.
How plus two students study, we all know. It is only from an examination point of view. Okay, 98.6 or 98.8 is what people care about. So whether you have understood or no, I don't think that is ever taken into consideration. So actually, if you are thinking of introducing, I don't know, it's like a wall which has to be broken with students actually. So I think the best way to start these things, especially these definitions, is by, I think, illustrating with some kind of an example. I don't know how I did it at engineering level when I studied. I did not do it this way. I did it when I first started teaching. So what I think of is always, I think of an orange. Okay. So the center of an orange is a point. Okay. And instead of think of a light bulb which is placed at the center of the orange. Okay. So the light bulb is going to emit in all directions. So it will form a sphere. Okay. Now throughout here, from now on, instead of a full sphere, we will deal with only the hemisphere. Okay, that is the first thing. So you will see words like hemispherical in irradiation, total hemispherical, etc. What it means is, we are looking at something which is going to occupy only the top portion of the sphere, which we will call as the hemisphere. Is that acceptable? So I have an orange which is cut into half, nothing is going down. The center of the orange is where the bulb is. The bulb is turned on, it is going to emit in all the directions, such that this angle goes from 0 to pi and this angle goes from 0 to 2 pi. Okay. So this picture, if you remember, I think life becomes very, very easy. I don't say it becomes very easy, it becomes easier. So now we have to look at the definitions from this picture point of view. So if in Cartesian, in two dimensions especially, we always deal with arc of a circle. Now arc is a difficult concept in terms of a hemisphere. So in fact, this picture in Sengel is very nice actually. This, he says, you think of a plane angle two dimensionally, we will call it arc length. And arc length is nothing but central angle is equal to arc length by the radius when the central angle is very, very small. Now this watermelon which he has shown here is exactly orange or watermelon, does not matter, it is the same thing in terms of concept. I am looking only at the top half, okay, and a portion which is shaded here, surface area S. Okay, this part is what I will be dealing with. So everything, we like to start with a differential control volume, differential area. Why? because unfortunately radiation is direction sensitive. Okay. So, if I can apply my logic of the definition to an infinitesimal surface area on the hemisphere, and so I am imagining that I am going to sit at this point. Okay, I am sitting here and the center of the hemisphere is going to see me. How is it seeing me? What is the angle subtended? Whether it is of radius r or radius 2r or 3r, the central angle is the same. So, the radius of the hemisphere does not matter. Is that appreciated? So, all that matters is the angle subtended, which is a function of my area. So, instead of calling it as a plane angle, we will call it as a solid angle, and the solid angle by definition is nothing but the area dAn. We use the normal area, okay. That is one thing which we have to keep in mind. Always we are talking of the normal or projected area. If the area is, yeah, go ahead.
Normal area means this is the direction in which my surface is seen. Normal area means I always use my hand. It should be normal. This is normal. What professor is saying is that if my area is like this on the top, then I have to make it normal. So later on we will see that some cos alpha will come with us to make it normal. But I always use my hands to, this is my direction and this is my surface. I have to make it normal. So this is my normal.
So, this I have drawn is the normal area. Okay. Now, if the area was oriented like this, actually throughout today both of us will, I think, interchangeably talk. So, because the subject is such that whatever input the other person gives is definitely going to be useful. So,
to be honest, actually what we have realized, we have to be thankful to all of you because you have propelled us to listen to each other. We have been teaching in independently in different classes at the same time, same material, but we never get an opportunity to sit in each other's class because of our whatever mundane regular stuff. But this has given us an opportunity to listen from each other and see the different perspectives. So we are learning from each other.
Thanks to
simultaneously
you.
Because of this course. That's one perceptible advantage what we have.
So, normal essentially refers to something which is perpendicular to the line which is drawn. So, this area here is normal to the line joining the center to the surface. Everybody appreciates that. Okay. This solid angle is nothing but dA by r square. The units is going to be steradian, S-T-E-R. S-T-E-R-A-D-I-A-N, steradian. So,
radian.
S.
For radian, other here we used to use radian, I just added,
S-T-E. Okay. So, this picture essentially is a part of the area which forms the hemisphere. Okay. So, we will call this angle in the horizontal plane. I get confused always with azimuthal and zenith angle. So, zenith I think is the one up, right, and this is azimuthal, yeah. So, that is how I remember, but sometimes I get confused. So, this phi is the azimuthal angle, this theta will be called as a zenith angle. So, now just look at this picture or look at this watermelon and we will sit there at this area and see. So, all this while we have dealt with heat flux. Q double prime. Okay. Now, in radiation, we are just changing the nomenclature, we call it intensity. That is the only change, conceptually it is the same thing. Heat coming per unit area, heat going per unit area, water heat received per unit area. This per unit area, instead of calling it as flux, heat flux, heat flux, we will call it intensity of radiation. Okay. So, it is a terminology which is changing, concept is not changing, it is per unit area. So, what is the energy that is absorbed, whatever we will not, we will fill in the appropriate words, per unit area, that is this shaded area of this surface. Okay. So, the word intensity, whenever we see the word intensity, it is like your heat flux, energy per unit area, watt per meter square. Is that okay?
So, intensity as watts per meter square. That's the question.
Yeah. So, I will come back to all this a little later. Intensity of emitted radiation. Why is radiation felt to be so complicated? I am sitting here, by virtue of a finite temperature, I will give out energy, right? I will also receive energy from everything surrounding me. I am standing here, this table generates radiation, it comes to me. You all of you, each one at a different location, generate some amount of energy by virtue of your temperature, your surface area, etcetera, some Q is coming. Depending on the relative position, a part of it comes to me. This light here gives me different energy, this light gives me much different energy. So, for that infinitesimal area dA, all the surrounding parts give some kind of energy. Okay. So, one thing the body does is by virtue of its finite absolute temperature, every body above absolute zero is going to have emission. What is emission? Giving out of energy, emit, that English is clear. So, by virtue of its finite temperature, it will give out some energy. We will refer to that word as emission. Anything with the word emission, emissive will be something related to outgoing. Emitting. Now, what we are saying is, okay, per unit area we want. So, we will call it intensity related to emission. Okay. Emission is watts, how much energy is emitted, how much heat is emitted, watts. Intensity of emission would mean how much energy is emitted per unit area of that surface. I am not showing any figure, just listen carefully. Okay. So, this surface by virtue of its finite temperature is going to emit a certain amount of energy per unit area, we will call it as intensity associated with emission. Okay. Intensity is given by symbol I, capital I. Okay. Now, books will say I subscript E will be intensity associated with emission. So, I is intensity, watt per meter square. Incorpora debit, I think even Schengel follows this. This E subscript refers to emission related quantity. Okay. So, intensity emission is double M, right? Single M. Double M. Okay, whatever is the spelling. Okay, single M. Okay. So, if it had been this simple, life would have been easy. Now, unfortunately, we have just seen, sir has told us that there is a wavelength dependency and an angular dependency, correct? Directional dependency as well as wavelength dependency. Now I am saying, I am looking here, I am standing on the road, I am counting the number of vehicles which are passing by outside IIT gate. That is easy. I do not have to deal with too much of concentration, I just have to sit and count. Now I say, count the number of red color cars going, red color cars. Okay. I have to be a little bit careful. Okay, because I am giving it an attribute. Okay. Life is a little bit difficult, but not so difficult. Now, I say count the number of red color cars going only from right to left. So, I should ignore what is coming from left to right. Okay. So, when I put in these conditions of directionality, I think that is too trivial an example, But what I am saying is, at this point when I am sitting, intensity of emission of what? It is going to emit over all the wavelengths or a range of wavelengths. What I am saying is, okay, I do not care about all these wavelengths, I look at a particular wavelength lambda, how much energy is emitted per unit area of that surface at that wavelength lambda. Okay. Now, that is the red color car. Now, I say, okay, that emission will happen in this direction, always think of this bulb. Bulb is going to emit in all directions, right. Now, I am saying I do not want all directions, this particular direction. What is that particular direction? This direction associated with the position of the infinitesimal area dA. Is that reasonably clear? I think if this part we appreciate, life becomes a lot easier. Okay. So, this subscript theta is there, right? Theta comma phi. Only theta I will put, because it makes life, or only theta, right? So, what started off as I, count all the vehicles going. So, left, right, you do not care, you will count everything. That is heat flux intensity. So, this is analogous to Q double prime. We relate to Q double prime very well, because we have seen it so many times. Now, the problem is, this is heat per unit area. Okay, very nice. First thing is, how much energy is, what is this? This is intensity associated with emission. Therefore, the subscript E has come. Okay, emission of what? Emission of energy at that wavelength lambda. Therefore, another subscript has come. Okay. That wavelength lambda may like only one particular direction, or two directions, or four, five directions. It may not emit uniformly in all directions, or it might emit uniformly in all directions. I do not care. All I care is this direction, what is the emission. So, that is why, what is this direction? This direction represents the relative position of my surface area dA with respect to the source of. Okay. So, my area dA, I am the area dA, I am emitting, let us say, some amount of energy. What is the energy of wavelength lambda which is reaching Mr. Vivek Korte? That is the directional dependency. What is reaching Vivek Korte will be different from what is reaching Parshuram, right. So, that is what is the directionality. Okay. I am looking only at a particular wavelength. If I say all wavelengths, then all I will have to do is remove the wavelength dependency, integrate over all wavelengths. Is that right? Now, if I say I want, yeah, Mangesh. Theta phi r
becomes too rigorous, so most of the textbooks. But now we are using that figure of that.
Yeah.
Here this is the azimuthal angle, and this one is the theta. It is the vertical axis. It is the theta.
Theta.
Now it is radiating in all directions.
Correct.
Now our surface is standing here.
Correct.
Okay. So this azimuthal angle will create a change.
No, how will I place my area other way?
You need two angles, no? How will I locate my area?
This,
how will I locate my point, for example, in the space? R, theta and phi only. We need. We cannot locate only with R and theta.
But the amount of radiation coming from source that we are talking about, center, okay, it is coming in theta direction, where our surface is located here.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct. Correct.
Radiations are going here and there.
Correct.
But what about this azimuthal angle and this surface area?
What is the question?
I'm not understanding the question.
See, what is your question? Will you please elaborate? It is going in the theta direction. Correct. Correct.
And the radiations are also in this.
In all directions there. Yeah. But we have taken, we have preferred only one direction. One particular direction, theta. We have preferred. Later on, I have to, later on I have to take all directions. But at this instant, just.
In fact,
no, no, my question is that whether the surface is standing at theta, right?
Surface cannot stand.
Whatever we are considering that infinitesimal small surface,
okay,
it is at an angle of theta.
My,
how will I locate that angle? How will I locate that area? It cannot be just
I
at
need
theta.
Two coordinates, na? R theta phi. R is not needed because we don't care about the size of the
size
hemisphere.
Of the right, huh.
But my position on the orange depends on R and depends on theta and phi. Okay. In fact, we did, if you go strictly by nomenclature, this is how it is. I e the subscript I will it will become like this. I
yes sir, I got it.
No, no, what was your question?
It is that means get this is the phi,
huh,
and you have to locate this area with respect to the theta as well as this phi.
Correct.
Like
correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Okay.
Thank
that
you. That is, otherwise I cannot locate, no? Otherwise, yes, we are taking direction theta, but I have to first locate my area as well, no?
It okay. is a ring. When you peel off the orange, each ring is at a different angle. Correct? Okay. Any questions, confusion? Now we will go to the blah, blah, blah textbook. Radiation intensity means heat flux associated or for emitted radiation is given by I subscript E bracket theta comma phi, that means a function of the direction, is defined as rate at which radiation energy dq watts is emitted in that particular direction per unit area, that is why it is heat flux, normal to that direction. Because if I am oriented in a non-normal direction, the surface area as seen is going to be smaller, which will be the projected area. So, it has to be the normal area per unit solid angle about this direction. What is this per unit solid angle coming? What it means is, see here, this I have understood this way. Maybe sir can have a different or better explanation, I do not know. As my slice of the orange changes, okay, this sector, shaded area sector, is subtending a solid angle d omega at the center. Now, if I take a larger sector, larger piece, it will subtend a larger angle at the center, ice cream cone. Smaller the cone, smaller the surface, I mean area of the cylinder of the circle on the top, your cone solid angle is smaller, same thing. Okay. So, per unit, everything is per unit basis, per unit area of the surface, per unit solid angle, okay, and it is in that particular theta phi direction. Theta and phi again are married, it goes together. Okay. Is that clear? So, when I apply this concept to emission, it is called intensity of emitted radiation. So, it is a function of theta phi applicable to E related to emission. And what is this missing? Lambda. In fact, this one concept I like Incropera a little bit better. Because he starts with the most general, he will say intensity of emitted radiation dq by dA cos theta d omega d lambda also. That means my units will be watt per meter square steradian micrometer. All the dependencies have come. This equation which is projected there is integrated over all the wavelengths. So, that d lambda has vanished. So, my definition actually would be, so this is radiation intensity, that would be called as spectral intensity, because it is that at that given wavelength. So again, it is, to be very honest with you, radiation is only understanding the terminology. When the word spectral comes, it is at a given wavelength. Okay, I will write it down for this, even for the sake of being repetitive. This means at given lambda. Okay, when it comes total, hemispherical, these two words come together, that means it has taken all wavelengths, all directions, because hemispherical means you are covering the entire hemisphere. So total hemispherical would mean all directions, all wavelength. Total spectral, what would that mean? Total spectral, a particular wavelength, how much of that is emitted in all directions. Is that clear? Total hemispherical, hemispherical and spectral. When this spectral word comes, it is a wavelength specific term, specific wavelength specific quantity. Okay. So this would probably be written as E I E lambda theta phi, which would be d q by d a I cos theta d omega d lambda. Correct, correct, na? Yeah. So what meter square, 1 minute, what meter square steradian micrometer. Yeah, I'll take a question.
Every body will emit energy at a particular wavelength, na?
At, it can emit over a range of wavelengths.
Depends on the temperature, as I said, it depends on the temperature for the range of the wavelength. When we go to the wavelength, emissive power versus wavelength, we will see at what temperature, what are the range of wavelength. Maybe we can flash that now also. See, at a particular temperature, you have, at every temperature, you have
different wavelengths. You have different wavelengths. You for every temperature, for example, you see 100 Kelvin, what is the wavelength range? Which is having emissive power, the lowest one, 10
to
near about 8 micrometer to 1000 micrometer. So now you go to the highest wavelength, sorry, highest temperature, 5800 Kelvin.
Yeah.
So it is, who is going to contribute? That contribution is going to be dependent on temperature, interdependency, both temperature and wavelength. Here, of course, temperature is not there, that will come later on, but here we are only worried about.
Yes.
My question is, how do I know which wavelengths I should take? That will be decided by temperature.
Yeah, Hemant has a question.
Sir, why are we taking this, as we see that radiation is a omnidirectional phenomena, and it is altogether creating a sphere to us. So why are we studying at land the heat transfer this between the surfaces in hemispherical concepts?
Yeah, yeah, I don't know, professor can correct. What, this what? Is hemi, why it is hemisphere, I will, this is how I have understood.
We all together, we all together cut, we all together cut the parts, and we are concerning mainly,
yeah, yeah,
on
I,
the
I,
hemisphere.
I understood, I understood. Why? Okay. Why? I, let me tell, maybe professor Arun can correct. So the way I understand is, how much my plate is going to see around me, if this is all I am emitting, let us say. Behind, I may not be emitting. If I am not emitting behind, why should I be worried about the other hemisphere? I am emitting only in front of me. If I am emitting in
the
both the
directions,
then I have to take the
whole
sphere. I am emitting only, that's a very good question. And anyway, I intended to tell that later on. But this, I always, my students always ask this question.
Who decides the hemisphere?
Hemisphere. This is how.
So, in fact, the bulb example, bulb is a sphere. It is giving you a sphere of field of interest.
I think to my mind, we merely concern, being a heat transfer engineer, we merely concern the heat flux of the wall and boundaries. So as I
no,
see
not
this
really, not really. I disagree with you. Not really. Not really. See, no, not really. You, it cannot be only on one direction. It can be both.
If you look
directions.
At flames, for example.
If I look at flame, if I put a body in a flame. If I put a body in a flame.
Sir, I'm discussing this thing in context with the, say for the example, I'm having the radius in the cuboid.
Okay.
So if I see the one surface, I'm having the temperature of this one surface. If this is emitting the radius into other surface, I simply
yes.
see this sphere.
Yes,
or
yes. In your application, what you
back,
said is yes.
Back,
we usually insulate in electrical furnaces or any furnaces.
Yeah, yeah.
What you said is right. Other side, but we are insulating. Only one side is we are forcing it to emit. That is their hemisphere is.
But at the same time, when intensity is passing from one surface to another surface and it travels to the
thank
path,
you.
This part is also going to create the space.
Hmm.
This the space is being described in terms of three dimensional.
No,
so here
no, no, it is three dimensional only. When I am taking r theta phi, where am I not taking three dimensionality?
So I am just trying to clarify my doubt.
No,
I am
no.
taking the hemispherical shape for the ball only.
Just for the case in which the emission is only in one direction, in one, what to say, one side. That's the right word, one side, not the other side. If it depends on application to application,
this
as you said, in application of furnace, it's only on one side, their hemisphere is enough. But if I have, let us say, a plate which is emitting on both sides, then I have to take complete sphere.
But this is just because we are not considering the participating media.
No, no,
no, no, no.
Nothing to do. Don't get confused.
It is probably for, first of all, I think it is for simplicity.
Simplicity.
First thing.
If you take. See, once you do for hemisphere, you is it going to be difficult to cover the other sphere, other hemisphere?
In fact, see this angle, zero.
It's not going to be, right?
Two.
It's only integration. You can integrate it. So, it is nothing to do with participating. Why did you bring the word participating medium here?
Because, see, when the intensity of radiation comes out from the surface and it travels to the path, suppose some particles are there which is really interacting.
Hmm.
So in spite of having the hemispherical surface at the wall, we have to consider the sphere when it is exactly in the medium.
There also same thing. There
no,
is
sir.
No, no. We have to understand this clearly. See, it is irrespective of whether it is participating or non-participating. First
okay.
thing is we are linking something which is not to be linked. No,
it's a very specific question because hemispherical means what? Hemispherical means we are merely
see,
worried about
participating
the heat
flux
near the ball.
Participating
only.
Has nothing
to
do with surface. It is representing the property of that medium. Here I have not brought any medium when I started the
yes,
discussion.
Sir, you are very much true. But my concern is we are simply taking this hemispherical concept just for the wall of the surface, just for the wall. But as soon as it leaves the wall, we have to consider the not hemispherical, complete sphere.
Now let us say, if I take that door, this door I take is emitting, it's sitting at a higher temperature and emitting. If I take r theta phi hemisphere, am I going to miss any of this? Am I going to miss any of the point in this room?
Take this.
Am I going to miss any of the point in this room? If the answer is no, then I am not making any mistake. But if the same wall, same door is emitting on
both the sides,
someone helped me with a word side, both the sides, then whatever I did for this hemisphere, I have to do the same thing for the other hemisphere.
If the two surfaces are different temperature, different coating, etc.
So, this side, this is the hemisphere.
Correct.
That side, that is the hemisphere.
That is the hemisphere.
The intensity, quantity can be same or different, depends on.
That's true.
Oh,
yeah. Day and night.
What
nice. Nice.
Correct. So, but then it is all radiation is going to be hemispherical is also not a right thing.
See, I think his question was when you go to participating media, it is the gas which is like a source which is going to go in all directions.
See, we should not get confused with participating medium. Why did I say? Let me complete. See, is again the same example if I take. What is that which will happen in a participating media? What is participating medium? So far we have taken non-participating medium. There is vacuum. But what am I saying? In a participating medium, what will happen in a participating medium with the basics whatever we have learned so far? My electromagnetic wave cannot move at the same speed. It's going to be so, and the medium which is there, like for example in a flame, I said if soot is there, the soot also starts emitting. So I again take packets of those soots all over this room and then start interacting with my door again. So where is the question of in participating medium full sphere has to be taken? There also I am taking, I am covering full room.
So for hemispherical medium, what is the solid angle we are taking? 2 pi.
We are not taking 2 pi.
Yes,
no, 2 pi means, okay, 2 pi means we are covering this half, na?
See here, na?
We are covering this half, na?
No.
I will not spend more time on this. I think we over coffee again, we will discuss. But I think we have covered every point. Let me summarize for the other guys. If you get confused because of this question.
So, in fact, then extrapolating is, why are we not doing it for quarter of a sphere? Why are we doing it for half the sphere?
Yeah. Why don't I do? That's a good way of convincing you. Why do I take
hemisphere?
Why cannot take a quarter of a sphere?
Or 1/8 of a sphere?
That's what we, same thing we are saying, no? Same thing, no? We are saying. But you
we
brought up with this question.
Top and bottom. We are demarcating it into two, top and bottom.
What Professor said is, if this is emitting, all this hemisphere I can cover with r theta phi. If this fellow is also emitting, then I have to be worried about this r theta phi. But if it is indeed emitting,
we have to do it. We will do it. We do
here in this analysis, to make it simple, we have taken right now only.
So why? Because if this is a solid surface, then you will have to take conduction effect through this. Are these at the same temperature or no? Then is it emitting at the same rate or no? What is the wavelength of this? What is the wavelength of this? What is the boundary condition on this surface? What is the boundary condition on this surface? So to forget all that, and especially when you are learning it at the initial stage, let us take it as only one surface. The other surface, we can treat it the same way as we treat this surface, provided we understand the concepts associated with the emission.
And both are not talking to each other. We can feel that. This light cannot go.
It cannot go. That is one.
If we understand that point, the light coming from this cannot go into the any of the ray which is coming from the top hemisphere.
See,
cannot go into the bottom hemisphere.
See, if I cut a circle here and keep that bulb. That bulb is, though it has the property to emit in all entire sphere, by virtue of this solid surface, the light will come out only in the top part. That is what we are focusing on. By virtue of a solid surface. Yeah. You have a question, Parshva?
No, sir. Just to say that we are going to any of for the derivation, we are going to take the center point. Either you take half portion of the sphere above or below, or on the right side or on the left side. Only azimuth part and zenith part is going to differ, but any of the derivation is going to remain same.
The question is why hemisphere, why not take a sphere, yes we can take a sphere, but we are considering the radiation only one part of the one direction, one side. We just showed na temperature, wavelength.
Okay, no problem. What does this figure tell? Different for a given temperature, I can have several
wavelengths.
Okay?
Yeah. It's okay.
We will be as patient as possible for radiation for a while
and
before we get into surface.
Now I think you realize why conduction we breeze through. Okay, we
this
want
is
this
conscious
whole
decision
day.
Why we have put it. Conduction we consciously,
I think even if we skip conduction it doesn't matter.
Because only you guys are all teaching great there. But convection radiation involves so much of thinking.
Okay. So, one second. So, what? Okay, probably because one surface will see only, okay, if you are talking of two surfaces, only the one portion is what is going to be seen. Okay, so I will come to the solid angle definition etcetera little later. See, now we said intensity associated with emission at a given wavelength at a particular, in a particular direction theta phi. Okay, where is that? This one. So, if I want to get q, that q would be obtained, this q would be obtained by dq is nothing but I e theta phi, if I want I can even put lambda, d a cos theta d omega d lambda. This is just bringing the numerator and the denominator, multiplying it. So, q essentially would be integration over all wavelengths over all theta over all phi, correct? Is that right? So, q, that is the what, the amount of heat, if you want to understand in layman's language, the amount of energy which is emitted by the entire area irrespective of the wavelength, irrespective of the directionality, that is obtained by integration of this. So, we define something like a heat flux, because it is not a constant, we had to go this way and then integrate it back to give you the total heat transfer. And when this quantity is associated with emission, we will give that symbol E. Okay. Is this okay? Now, we will just extend, this is called as emissive power, by the way, I forgot to mention. It is the radiation heat flux for emitted radiation is called as the emissive power, which is defined as the rate at which radiation energy is emitted per unit area of the emitting surface. Okay. So, you have taken the definition, just put it on the other side and you will get the amount of heat transfer. Okay. Now, what I am saying is, keeping the same idea, same concept, if I do not talk about emission and I talk about reception of energy, okay, that surface is getting energy. I am that surface, or let me go back to my watermelon. I am this sitting here. I am getting energy in all possible directions, all possible wavelengths, all possible directions per unit area. So, this is my unit area, that is very nice. Now, I am saying, what is the energy that is coming at a particular wavelength to me in that particular direction? So, from Vivek Korde to me, what is the amount of energy which is coming at a wavelength lambda? I do not care about lambda minus delta or lambda plus delta, this wavelength lambda which I specify, in this direction, what is the amount of energy coming? That when I apply it to incoming radiation, I will call it as irradiation. Okay. Irradiation refers to terms associated with energy coming to, received by that surface. Exactly the same concept, nothing different. Only thing will change is all surfaces emit radiation, also receive radiation emitted or reflected by other surfaces. I do not care what is the nature, how is it coming. is it coming directly from him or reflected portion of this tube light energy which is coming to me, I do not care. As long as an energy of wavelength lambda is coming from that direction to me, that I will call as my irradiation associated with that wavelength and that particular direction. So, this is given by symbol G. Okay. So, G essentially is just a nomenclature again, and what happens is this IE, instead of E, the subscript will become small I, because it is for irradiation. That is the only change. Conceptually it is exactly the same. When it was for emission, it was associated with energy leaving the surface by virtue of its temperature. I am stressing this again and again, because we will introduce radiosity, which is a slightly different concept. Emission is associated with the temperature of that body. So, energy leaving that surface per unit area in that direction theta phi per unit wavelength lambda through that solid angle d omega and reaching the area normal d a n, all those things remain the same. Now, instead of emission, I am talking of reception incoming. So, it is called as irradiation. I think is connect has been made, I think. Now, last thing, okay, every surface gets energy, also emits energy. Amount of energy coming from there to me, I will reflect also, a portion of it I will reflect. So, a portion of that reflected energy plus the emitted energy. So, E is emission, this part you see here, R is the reflected part, exactly the same. So, amount of energy blah 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 blah, everything emitted plus reflected portion of incident radiation. Again, it is at that specific wavelength at that specific direction. So, when I have the direction wavelength dependency, I will call as spectral. When I do it for the whole area and overall wavelength, it will be called as a total, hemispherical. Are these terms clear? I think these terms, once they become clear, it is very, very easy to communicate. So, it is, we are teaching English at this point to students. So, what is spectral? At a given wavelength. What is total, hemispherical? All wavelengths, all directions. Irradiation is referring to quantities which are related to incoming radiation. Radiosity given by symbol J refers to emitted portion, which is a virtue of its finite temperature, plus the reflected portion of incoming radiation. So, incoming radiation can be from him, from him, from him, from all the places to me. Out of the incoming radiation, what is the reflected portion in that theta phi direction? Okay, I do not care from where the incident incoming radiation has come. So, this tube light, this wooden shelf, all of you are going to emit radiation which I will receive. Out of the incoming radiation, what is reflected, rho times that quantity in that particular direction, at that particular wavelength, plus the corresponding quantity which I am emitting by virtue of my finite temperature in that direction at that wavelength, is what is radiosity. I do not think I can make it any clearer. Okay. So, this is the G, which is the irradiation, this is the emissive power, this is the radiosity. The mathematics is just same thing. dq is blah blah blah. So, I will just go through the mathematics quickly for complete. Yeah, I will go to solid angle first and then come. Okay. Now, having understood hopefully these terms, we will come to a easier part, which is solid angle. So, we have defined solid angle as d a n by r square. So differential area dN, which is normal to theta phi direction as in the figure, dAN, this one is, we are going to give it a form in the r theta phi that way. So we are calling this angle theta, this is r sin theta, this length, radius of this arc is r sin theta. So r sin theta times this angle, plane angle, which is d phi, because this triangle and this triangle are similar triangles, the triangle at the base and this triangle are identical in shape, similar triangles. The central angle here is d phi, the central angle here is also d phi. So the arc length of this surface and the corresponding surface is essentially r sin theta d phi. This surface is nothing but r d theta, this arc length. So, mouse is not moving, this arc length is r d theta, they move around, it's fine. So the area essentially is a rectangle which is given by r sin theta d phi times r d theta, which will come out to be r square sin theta d theta d phi. All these I think is just geometry, all of us know it. So d omega is essentially d a n by r square, which comes out to be sin theta d theta d phi. So wherever in the next page when we start to do the intensity etcetera, d omega is replaced by sin theta d phi. Okay. So for the sphere, solid angle is essentially obtained by integration over all theta and all phi. So it comes out to be 4 pi r square, which is the total area.
How can we get per unit area and per unit solid angle? Because it is related by radius. So is it a particular radius?
Per unit area when I took d a 1. Per unit solid angle I took d a n. D a 1 says how much from what area it is. D a n says through which area it is
going.
He told no different ice cube. What is
that? Ice cream cone.
Ice cream cones. It depends how big is my ice cream. If my ice cream cone is a big ice cream cone, I need lesser ice cream cones to complete my sphere, a hemisphere. If I have smaller ones, I need
so this is
how much it is covering, to how much direction it is covering, that is dA. That is
dA. This is what. So this one is smaller, this one is much larger.
dA1, which is like, yes.
Irradiation is referring to collector. Irradiation is reception. Emission and radiosity are linked because both of them have to be for the same surface which is emitting. By virtue of a temperature, it is emitting, also it is reflecting. So it is for the surface which is giving out. This surface which this is talking to, it is also receiving. So when I talk of irradiation, it is for the receptor. So at that time this becomes a receptor taking in energy from all other surfaces surrounding it. Okay. Huh? Correct. Exactly. See, I think a visual picture, if it is there, I think life becomes very easy to teach this. So differential solid angle dAN by r square. So intensity of emitted radiation has covered this, total emissive power. So hemisphere above the surface intercepts all the radiation rays emitted by the surface. The total hemispherical emissive power from the surface surrounding it is given by integral from theta going from 0 to pi by 2, and so I do this and go on. Because I am taking only half the hemisphere, na?
Let me cover. I have to cover the hemisphere. How will I cover the hemisphere? This is 2 by 2. Any point, if I have to cover 190 is sufficient, no?
So I do this and I rotate. So I form a quadrant on a plane, and a rotation of a quadrant gives you a hemisphere, right? That's what it is. I think apart from dancing, we have done everything. It's hard.
How do I get a cone? So I take a equilateral triangle.
I take a triangle and rotate it.
So it's like that.
Yeah.
So in drawing, we take this effort to make them understand.
Come back again.
No.
4 pi, how is it possible here? Yeah? Theta will be minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2.
Why it cannot become
4 pi? Phi is this angle. Phi is this angle. Phi is only 2 pi. 2 pi is 360 degrees, no?
You are rotating, na?
Rotation is only for 360 degrees, which is 2 pi. The theta will go from minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. That 4 pi is actually 2 times 2 pi. This 2 pi is because of this, yeah. And the second is because it is an even function.
So why
do
you
say
4 pi will be for both the sides?
No, don't confuse. Don't confuse.
I am not going to discuss that. I am not serious. I am not going to discuss that.
Hey, Hemant, this one, see this theta is going from 0 to pi by 2. So, theta going from minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. Show me.
Convince me.
One second. What is this? Theta.
Rotating. You said rotating. So how much is the rotating angle? That's it.
You don't take a quarter anymore. You take a semicircle and rotate.
Yes, sir. But it is only for
the semicircle is.
How do you get the second part?
You take a semicircle and rotate a semicircle. You'll get it. So semicircle is that is 2. You are still rotating by 2 pi. The semicircle quadrant has become a semicircle because I have changed it from 0 to pi by 2, it has become minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2. So, this is my semicircle, minus pi by 2 to plus pi by 2 when I rotate, which will become 2 times integral 0 to pi by 2. Okay.
I think it's fine. Hemant, you go back and visualize. We will discuss.
Or chai. I think too much discussion. Okay, so this is intensity of flipping, intensity of emitted radiation, we said this already. The intensity of radiation emitted by a surface in general varies with direction, but many surfaces in practice can be approximated as diffuse. What is diffuse surface? Independent of direction. So, for diffuse emitting surface, intensity of emitted radiation is independent of direction, therefore, I E is a constant. So, I can just pull that out. I will say E is equal to pi times I. This is just maths, you can do the maths. Okay, and there is a small problem, I can skip that. Radiation incident, which we call as irradiation. Intensity of incident radiation is defined as the rate at which radiation energy dg is incident from theta phi direction per unit area of receiving surface. Again the same blah blah blah, normal to this direction per unit solid angle about this direction per, if I was using lambda subscript, per unit wavelength lambda d lambda blah blah, between the direction of incident radiation and the normal to the surface. So, once the concept is clear, you can put it in words. So, g is nothing but dg integrated for the hemisphere, the total radiation flux incident on a surface from all directions. So, I am sitting at the center of the hemisphere, what is the total flux which is coming on to me, that is what I am calculating here, which is nothing but integration over theta going from 0 to pi by 2, phi from 0 to 2 pi, which comes out to be again pi times I subscript I. This subscript is for irradiation. Radiosity accounts for all the energy leaving the surface by radiation. It is the sum of reflected portion of incident energy plus the emitted energy, that is why E plus R. So, the rate at which radiation energy leaves unit area of surface in all direction, and we have seen that. Here we come, spectral quantities are wavelength dependent. So, I will define only one of this, everything else will follow. Okay. Spectral radiation intensity for emission, I intensity, lambda spectral, E emission, this is at that wavelength theta phi, is nothing but dq divided by dA1 cos theta, which is the normal area, d omega is that per unit solid angle business, d lambda is that per unit wavelength. So, essentially, because this is the definition, actually dq, if I have to calculate, is just the product of the left hand side and this one. So, I lambda E, which is a function of lambda theta phi times dA1 cos theta sin theta d phi, which is a solid angle, times d lambda. So, a triple integration, that is what will be there on the next page, triple integration over theta, over phi, over all lambda will give me whatever I got, total hemispherical emissive power, that is over all wavelengths, over all directions. Okay. You had a question, sorry. We have not brought any temperature into picture here.
Temperature is not in picture.
Right.
Yes. So, if the surface is not homogeneous,
then its characteristics of emission will be different at different points of the surface. Correct.
For each surface, I have to again
subdivide
them into several areas, and for each area, we have.
This is applicable to a surface irrespective of the size of the surface. Of course, it is applicable to a surface at a finite temperature. The surface can be a small surface, finite fixed temperature.
Then only it gets the range of the wavelength gets fixed. Otherwise, as you said, if it is multiple temperatures, then I am going to have multiple wavelengths.
Okay. So, this definition, if I take the denominator up and integrate with respect to theta and phi, that means I am keeping the wavelength dependency still. Okay. So, spectral hemispherical emissive power. That means, at that wavelength lambda over the hemisphere, what is the emissive power? So, that is obtained by E subscript lambda. So, all of us are familiar with E. When the subscripts come, that is where the problem occurs. So, this lambda indicates it is emission at a particular wavelength. Okay, that concept should become clear. So, it is just obtained by integration with respect to theta and phi. So, again it is watt per meter square at a particular wavelength. Okay. So, when the variation of spectral, it should be watt per meter square steradian actually, right? Yeah, watt per meter square steradian. When the variation of spectral intensity radiation, micrometer, sorry, not steradian, micrometer. When the variation of spectral radiation intensity with I lambda wavelength, the total radiation intensity for emitted, incident or emitted and reflected, whatever, will just be integrated over the entire spectrum. So, I lambda E would be integrated from 0 to infinity over all wavelengths.
So, let me just ask a question just to check whether we have reached you or not. What does this 0 to infinity mean? What does this 0 to infinity mean?
I just answered.
Huh? Yeah, we just answered, but let us see. 0 to infinity means what? Literally, should I be taking 0 to infinity? No. Band of the spectrum which is really contributing the thermal radiation for a given
temperature.
For a given temperature. We have to thank you. You reminded that this is for a fixed temperature. That was not stated explicitly.
I think
it
was
fixed temperature. When I fix the temperature, my wavelength range gets
fixed.
So once I get the wavelength range, my this 0 to infinity gets fixed.
So it is not 0 to
infinity.
It is some lambda 1 to lambda 2.
That is what I wanted to emphasize. It's not, it is just stated for the sake of
generality.
But case by case, that if, is case if, is getting fixed by temperature.
If I want to make life difficult for a student, I will give some multiple peaks. Okay, just nonsense. But what we are saying is it is integrated over several wavelengths. Okay. So this same definition holds good for E, G and J. So, this is something which we present. So, this is first one is you tell me total.
What is? No. You
full,
cannot.
Full big word.
You have to qualify it. Hemant Kumar from Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. That's what qualifies you. So, you have to qualify what is this emissive power. Total.
Emissive power.
That's
at that temperature.
At that temperature.
G is J total hemispherical radiosity. Okay. I think the message is gone. Okay. So
okay. So now we have got the definitions clear. Actually, there are two ways of teaching. See, to not to scare the student even. I was just in the morning also, I was dilly-dallying, should we be starting radiation with intensity? In fact, we can go Chengal's way also. See, this is the way Incorpora approaches thermal radiation. So, what perhaps to make, to ease, I mean, or the, to keep the students at ease with radiation, what Chengal does is actually, what he does is first he gives this introduction, all this introduction, and he immediately after this, he will immediately go to black body. Why black body? Because in emissive power, when I say emissive power is something which is independent of, I use the word emissive power only when it is independent of direction. It is used when directionality comes, I use intensity. That's what his approach is. So it is not a, it's not a bad idea to come from, first come from black body radiation. Here you do not need intensity anything. You have to just state, maybe it is a good idea, maybe it is a good idea. Otherwise, if they do not get those definitions, they are thrown out of gear. So, my suggestion would be after going through this, this time we are going to teach this way only, that is, let us not first give them the definitions. So, we can come to black body. They would be knowing Planck's distribution, we will be stating that, I mean, I do not know what Professor Arun would opine on this, this approach, but only thing is that otherwise we have to spend so much time, as much as Professor Arun spent maybe one class, two classes only going through those definitions. You see, we had enough fights in understanding each other. So, we should go through those fights in the class so that we have reached them clearly, then perhaps we can go this. Otherwise, we can make little easier by coming till here, but there is a problem when we come to band emission because I have to introduce intensity again. So that is the problem. So, I think we can go the way we went, then I think that is the best way. I think we will calibrate, we will go best way, I think we will calibrate ourselves to go Incorpora's way. Okay.
But one word of caution. I don't know, you all give notes for this, for how many of you give notes for
students? NITs, I think they will not give, other places. So, you write on the board? Okay. No, the thing is, because these definitions, all these things, I think they have to just listen first and appreciate it. Okay. For a student to read this and understand is next to impossible, first time. So, I think you have to insist that they hear you out first. They listen to you first and then write it down. So maybe I will suggest that don't spend time writing on the board. And then just hand out maybe, yeah, something like that you ask them. Don't, the time can be better utilized to it.
No dictation.
Okay, no dictation, right? So that is something, because if you are writing, the students are just busy copying that.
So actually, to come back to the same question, now that this course is over and you have complete material given PDF file, you can make it as a book or a handout or chapter by chapter you can give. They can bring that. I was thinking that if they only print it on one side, on the left side, whatever extra you tell and write it on the board over and above the material what is there in this notes, they can write that. Then perhaps even if they don't read a textbook, perhaps we have reached them. Of course, we should encourage them to read a textbook. In fact, I tell my students to bring textbook to class, whichever textbook you like. Then I keep saying I like you because you have brought the textbook. Just to inculcate the habit of having a book with them, okay. So I think this way, if we do, we can reach them in a faster fashion and more effectively, perhaps. Okay.